And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this. I did it my way.
Who's trying to keep up with him? And it's a matter of whether or not Jared Goff can get the ball.
I've had a few,
and he has to do it.
But then again, too few to mention.
Jameson Williams looking for.
I did what I had to do. Saw it through without exemption.
It's the deep threat.
I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway. More, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was dark, my fill, my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that.
He gets out in space,
and may I say, not in a shy way. Oh no, oh no, not me. I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say.
Welcome back, everybody, to a brand new episode of Into the Lion's Den here on the Heavy Hitter Network. I am your host, as always, Mario Romanelli, getting you ready to get you into the Super Bowl mode coming up in just 2 weeks, two more weekends, I guess I should say. Of course, this coming weekend will be the Pro Bowl, and then next week will be the Super Bowl, and we know it will be the Kansas City Chiefs taking on the San Francisco 49ers. So a little down, of course, being a Lions fan, that we were not able to finish out the season the way we wanted to. We got very, very close. And at times in that game, it looked like it was a no doubter. But of course, some stuff did not go our way. So what are you going to do? It's still a season to celebrate. And that is why I chose to start the show off with highlights, the 10 best plays of the season, because I kind of compare it to when you have a loved one pass away, You do not put up pictures at their funeral of them being sick in the bed at the hospital or at home. You actually put vibrant pictures, pictures that you want to remember them by. And I want to remember this team of the 2023 season for all the good things they did and for all the joy they did bring to all the fans, not just Lions fans either, by the way, nationwide. They really became America's team. And I know that sounds cliche because we hear that a lot with the Dallas Cowboys, but there's no question in my mind that when we got to that championship game, unless you're a resident of California, you pretty much were probably pulling for the Detroit Lions. And just what an amazing team it was, what an amazing time, and a lot of good coming out of that. So we're going to touch on the games that got these teams to the Super Bowl, of course, but with it being an extended time since it happened, I don't want to spend too much time on that. We're going to spend more time on looking forward to the Super Bowl, and we're also going to take time to look ahead at the Detroit Lions, their schedule for next year, and also just their offseason and kind of what it's looking like early on. So going to spend more time on that kind of stuff. But like I said, I've got to at least touch on what happened in the championship games to get us to the Super Bowl. So we will get that started in just a little bit. But before we do, first, I want to thank you guys for coming back, checking us out again. If you're new, thank you also for taking a chance and checking out the show. I think you'll enjoy it. I always get positive feedback on this show. So that's very exciting to me and humbling at the same time. But I want to tell you real quick how you can contact us. And I should say, because this show, the season's about ready to end, and I have other shows. So the contact information I'm about to share with you is for all the shows. So no matter what show I'm doing, if you guys want to reach out to us and give your comments, suggestions, whatever you got for us, you can use all these same contacts. So with that being said, let's tell you about them. Okay, so if you want to contact us, you can email us by going to heavyhitterspodcast@gmail.com. You can call the hotline 1-616-258-6386, or you can go check us out on our website, heavyhitternetwork.org. And then also, if you like what I'm doing, if you want to support the show, support the network, there is costs that go into this, running the website, the cameras, the internet, all that. A lot of cost in this. You can always help me out by tipping the host. And you can do that one of two ways. You can either scan the QR code that you see on the screen, or if you're more comfortable, you can go to Venmo and look for @MarioRomanelli. No spaces, no hyphens, just @MarioRomanelli. And you can put your tips there. And then also, if this is your first time checking us out, maybe you've got a link sent to you to check us out. This is where you can find us. You can go to Rumble and search HH Network, or you can go to YouTube and search Heavy Hitter Network. And when you guys are there, I always ask that, of course, you take a moment to subscribe. And then, of course, you can always find us on heavyhitternetwork.org, where all of our videos are at one place. And that is our website. So definitely the easiest way to go would be the website, in my opinion. And then also, if you want to just listen to the shows, you don't need to necessarily watch them. You can do that by visiting us on Spotify, iTunes, Google Podcasts, etc. by searching Heavy Hitter Network. Very excited to also remind you guys that right now, out on the network, it is now available on Rumble, YouTube, and the website. It is Spotlight Tribute Episode 1, and I can tell you the views have already been there. People are giving me a lot of feedback that they're enjoying it, and I got to tell you, there's a whole lot more coming in this series in the month of February. So I'm right now actually trying to put out maybe a fifth episode, which would mean that this week I would be releasing Episode 2, even though it was actually supposed to be Episode 1, but I got a head start. And there's so much music I'm finding and just really enjoying putting these series together. I'm going to try and get you guys a bonus show. We will see more information to come on that. And that's where, if you are following us on the website, you would get emails right to your own personal email with notices saying that a new show has come out. So that's why I always say you guys should be subscribing. If you go to Rumble or YouTube or the website, definitely subscribe so you're getting all that information when we drop a new show. And then also don't forget the return of the Fielder's Choice Baseball Show on February 10th. And we're going to be starting out with the National League West. That's right, Diamondbacks, Rockies, Giants, Dodgers, Padres. If you're a fan of those teams or just a baseball fan in general, I highly suggest you check that show out. I put a lot of research, a lot of time into that show, and I'm very excited about what I've put together so far, and I cannot wait to release it to you guys. So again, that's going to be coming out February 10th, so just about a week away from putting out the first episode with that. And we are going to be doing each division. Each division will be fully covered by the time we get to the baseball season. I'm planning on putting out one show per week. And like I say, the first show will be the National League West. All right, let's get into the conference championship review. Okay, so it all started on Sunday. The Kansas City Chiefs taking on the Baltimore Ravens. The Chiefs took a 14-7 lead with 10:56 to go in the first half, and they would never look back. And look, I was shocked. Baltimore has been playing on a completely different level all season long, and I really expected them to run through the Kansas City Chiefs. But it just was not in the cards for them. Lamar Jackson did not play well, which is now becoming a trend for this guy. Like, this is something that he's been dealing with. He does not play well in the big playoff games. And you can call it bad luck, call it what you want. But right now, it is a growing trend that was definitely talked about before this game. And it's only going to catch more steam now as he has another lackluster performance. Kansas City would hold Baltimore to just 3 more points for the rest of the game after 10:56 in the first half. First half. So, I mean, the majority of the game, Baltimore is just being shut down. Baltimore would go 3-for-11 on third downs, and they would have 3 turnovers. Baltimore would only make 1 trip to the red zone, but they would end up with a Zay Flowers fumble at the goal line. So they had their one shot, and they fumbled it away. And then Kansas City, they're going to return to the Super Bowl, get this, for the 4th time in the last 5 seasons. So in a era where it's very hard to say there's dynasties anymore, I think you have to say the Kansas City Chiefs are a dynasty. 4 out of 5 years, I don't care who you are, that's a dynasty. 2-for-1 over their last 3 Super Bowl appearances. Of course, they beat the Eagles last season 38-35. In this game, Patrick Mahomes went 30 of 39, 241 yards, threw a touchdown. He was sacked twice but didn't turn the ball over and had a quarterback rating of 100.5. Lamar Jackson, on the other hand, had a quarterback rating of 75.5. Did throw an interception, was sacked 4 times. Isaiah Pacheco had another good day for the Chiefs. Nothing eye-popping, but just very efficient. And his running game has really helped this team in the playoffs, along with the Kansas City defense. Kansas City's defense in this one, 4 sacks, 3 tackles for losses, 2 fumble recoveries, an interception, and 7 quarterback hits. So that was a very good performance. And all season long, I've been saying, it's the Kansas City Chiefs defense that has allowed this team to put up the record they have and to make it as far as they have. And it just continues. They have a great defense. And then also, yes, Travis Kelce, 11 catches, 116 yards and a touchdown in this one to help the Chiefs get the victory. And then, of course, the late game on Sunday was the Detroit Lions taking on the San Francisco 49ers. What a game it was. Really, the tale of two halves. Detroit came out and dominated in the first half, holding the 49ers to just 38 rushing yards and 8 first downs. But it was a second half that absolutely really showed the 49ers rushing attack, and something that the Lions have been good against all year long. No matter who they've been playing against, they have been able to control the run. And for one half of this game, they did the same. But it didn't matter. Christian McCaffrey and the 49ers recovered from a huge deficit to avoid losing their third straight conference title game. And that would have been something. You know, we just talked about how Lamar Jackson kind of has had a history in not being able to perform in the big games. 49ers are kind of trending that way as well. But unfortunately, they will be heading to the Super Bowl for the first time since 2019, where they did lose to the Kansas City Chiefs 31-20 back then. But I talked about the second half, and like I say, the 49ers in the second half, 117 rushing yards in the second half. They also had 15 first downs in the second half and really controlled the clock, and just they scored on every drive in the second half. As far as Detroit, they were held to 34 rushing yards in the second half. They did pass for 241, but when they couldn't stop the 49ers, it really didn't matter at that point, because they would suffer 3 turnovers, two of them coming on downs, turnover on downs, 2 fourth down attempts. 49ers scored on their 5 second half drives, 3 touchdowns, 2 field goals, and it was enough to take the lead and get the win. I'm not going to spend a lot of time ranting and raving about Dan Campbell's decisions, because I'll just say check my track record on his fourth down decisions this season, and you will know exactly how I feel about it. People can make excuses for him. They can say what they want to. And look, I've heard both. I've heard both sides, right? I've heard opinions that agree with mine, and I've heard opinions that completely disagree with mine. And that's sports. That's life. You're never going to get 100% consensus on anything. But I will just say, this was our opportunity. We had our opportunity. We were in the driver's seat. We had one half. We were one half away from getting to the Super Bowl, and decisions were made that played into the results. And yes, we had some receivers that should have caught balls. We should have had, you know, a lot of things could have gone a lot of different ways. And unfortunately for us, they just didn't. So we had some bad luck at times, and they made some incredible plays at times. And at the end of the day, it is what it is. The 49ers move on, and the Lions will move on to the offseason and really try and improve on what they can do from here moving forward. But spotlights for this one, Christian McCaffrey, who still was playing banged up, 20 carries, 90 yards, 2 touchdowns, 42 receiving yards. Very impressive from him. And then Deebo Samuel, this was a guy I really was hoping might be a little banged up, too banged up to play, but he made it in, and he made an impact. And I'm not surprised by that, because that's what this guy does. Really was kind of held quiet the first half, but in the second half, he played a big part of this comeback and ended up with 8 catches for 89 yards. Another quick comparison on these two teams: third downs, both teams were 6 for 12. Fourth downs, the 49ers were 0 for 1. The Lions were 1 for 3. And red zone, the 49ers were 4 for 5. Lions 3 for 4. So a very close, hard-fought game. But it really, it was a heartbreaker. Because like I say, anybody that was a Lions fan in that first half, a lot of people excited on social media, but also a lot of people very cautious, because you just could feel something was going to happen, and sure enough, it did. But congratulations to Dan Campbell and the Detroit Lions on such a successful and just enjoyable season. And again, congratulations to the 49ers for making it to the Super Bowl. We take a look at the rookie report one last time this season, and in the championship game, Sam Laporta, 9 catches, 97 yards. Brian Branch, 4 tackles. 3 of those were solo, and 1 was for a loss. Jack Campbell, 7 tackles. 4 of those were solo. And Jahmyr Gibbs, 12 carries, 45 yards, and a touchdown, along with 3 catches and 11 yards. So my final take of the season, with a 14-point lead, Detroit had a 4th and 2 at San Francisco's 28-yard line. They failed to convert the 4th down, and at this point, there was 6:58 to go in the 3rd quarter, and we were up by 14 still with that. So we held that lead quite a ways into the game. Brandon Ayuk, I talked about some incredible plays. This was one of them. Brandon Ayuk caught a 51-yard reception off the mask of Kendall Vildor, who really made a great defensive play. Just bad luck that it hit right off his mask, and it bounced right to Ayuk's hands, and it was a huge play at the time. So, again, there's nothing that you really can do with plays like that. They're going to happen, and we just couldn't stop the bleeding after that. Jahmyr Gibbs' fumble, another just crusher, recovered by San Francisco at Detroit's 24-yard line. That also led to another touchdown. So, I mean, you take just those two plays alone, and those were really a huge part of the second half. I'm not going to light up Jahmyr Gibbs for the fumble. Fumbles are going to happen at a running back position. They're never at a good time, right? But, I mean, it was a crucial moment in that game to have that happen at that spot of the field, at that time of the game. It just was just rolling downhill at that point, our whole momentum. And then Detroit trailing by 3 had 4th and 3 at San Francisco's 30-yard line. And again, they failed to convert on a 4th down. At this point, there was 7:32 to go in the 4th quarter. And it just allowed the 49ers to then extend the lead. And really, there was a late timeout that also Dan Campbell is being crushed for. And I'm sorry, he should be. This is, you know, being a head coach comes with responsibilities and accountability. And look, the timeout that he took late in the 4th quarter, we needed that timeout. It was horribly, you know, to his credit, he stands up there and he says, look, I thought we could run it in. I thought we, you know, we had passed our whole way down there. I figured they were looking for the pass, thought we could run it in. But you really have to be playing the clock there. And I'm sure he understands that now. But I saw so many videos on YouTube of fans reacting live. And when you've got that many fans reacting live the same way, saying, what are you doing? Why are you taking a timeout? You just, you know, we don't have any time left now. Now we got to make an honest. I mean, everybody's understanding it except him. So I think really the thing I want to see from Dan Campbell next year is just growth as a head coach, growth in game management. I'm not going to sit here and light him up anymore. I'm not going to, you know, question every 4th down he does, because it is who he is at the end of the day. And if the Fords are okay with that and they don't want to look for a new head coach that doesn't do that, then I guess we'll ride with whatever Dan Campbell does. But here we go in the last game of our season. It ended up costing us was a lot of poor game management from Dan Campbell. And I will leave it at that. Something that also came out of the game afterwards was a message on Facebook from Aiden Hutchinson, which I just thought was so classy. And it really, I think, was something all the fans needed to hear, because fans were going after each other just for their opinions. And we got to remember, guys, everybody's entitled to an opinion. We're not going to agree as a Lions community, but I saw a lot of people, you know, telling other people that you're not a Lions fan, and just kind of crazy stuff, really. I mean, just too extreme in my opinion. But I did like this from Aiden Hutchinson. So what he said was, you won't find tears in Detroit. If you want excuses, you won't hear them coming from Ford Field. As hard as today's loss was, it is not a definition of the Detroit Lions culture. It's a testament to how far we have come and how far we can go. It is the city's perseverance of hardworking people is what makes this state great. A city born in steel, diesel, and blood will not let a moment like this hold them back. In a city like this, and a culture like this, you learn that failure is just an opportunity to improve. A moment that Michigan men don't shy away from. You take a look at those college boys down the road. It took them a couple trips to hell and disappointment, all to bring glory back to Michigan. Greatness is a journey, not a light switch, and it may take a few more days in the dark to see the light, but the Lions will get there. Together, we will restore the roar. Romans chapter 5, verses 3 through 4 says, not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not put us to shame. Very classy words from Aiden Hutchinson. Big news, unfinished business. Offensive coordinator Ben Johnson turns down two head coaching jobs, one with Washington, one with Seattle, and Aaron Glenn does not get his opportunity to get a head coaching position either. Both men returning next year. So we have got our coaching staff in check and we're ready to roll. We're ready to go on and try and do this thing again. Like everybody's saying, let's run it back. One more time. Let's do it again. Let's try and get even farther. Another change the Lions have made. Lions hire Terrell Williams as running game coordinator, D-line coach. Williams spent the previous six seasons with the Titans. He coached Tennessee's defensive line from 2018 to 2023. For the 2023 season, the Titans added assistant head coach to his title. So for those that don't know, what does a run game coordinator do? Somebody did ask on Twitter, and this was what it says. The question was, so does run game coordinator mean he coordinates how we plan to stop the run, or is he working with both sides of the ball? Answer from Eric Schlitt, both. Scouts opponents to see how to stop their rushing attack, and scouts their defense to see how to beat them, to beat their run defense, and pass his report on to Lions offense. I like this. And from everything I'm reading about this guy, people say this is a huge hire. So this is only going to make us stronger going into next year, better prepared. And so that's a great thing. And the Lions wasting no time in making, you know, moves, locking up coaches, bringing in somebody new. I saw Dre Bly got added to the coaching staff as well. So, I mean, they're definitely already rolling on next season as other teams are just basically rolling out theirs. You know, we're just getting down to the Super Bowl here. Lions are in the news every day, it seems like, doing something. So we came in with four teams, and then, yes, unfortunately, one by one, they dropped away. And that left just two in the playoffs. But we flip it over. We run it back. And it is now the Super Bowl. Kansas City Chiefs, San Francisco 49ers. So we take a look at the injury report as it is today. And you can see we've got some injuries from both teams, some big names as well. Emenhenu, torn ACL, he's out. So defensive end for the Chiefs, out. That's not going to be, we don't need to look into that any further. But Kadarius Toney, hip and ankle, questionable. There's a lot of controversy around this one, guys, if you have not been paying attention. Kadarius Toney coming out and saying this is not true. He is not injured. He can play. And they're basically lying and putting him on the injured list. So a lot of drama, I'm sure, will follow this whole season with the Chiefs and Kadarius Toney. But I did see where he says this is basically lies, and he is not injured. Linebacker Willie Gay dealing with a neck injury. He is questionable. And then Joe Thuney, the guard, dealing with pectoral. He is doubtful. Not out yet, but doubtful. So it does not sound good for him as well. For the 49ers, George Kittle still dealing with a toe injury, which he did suffer and was dealing with in the Detroit Lions game. he did miss practice on Thursday. So still sounds like it's going to be tough for him to be out there. And even if he is, I do not think he will be at 100%. I will say that much. So yes, it sounds kind of silly that, oh, he's just got a toe injury, but it does sound like it could be definitely affecting his performance, I should say. And then Ambry Thomas, cornerback, ankle injury. He is also listed day to day. So they did say George Kittle also listed day to day, but like I say, missing practice still dealing with it. And they're saying basically, you know, if he's out there, it's because he's gritting through something. He's not going to be 100% no matter what he does by the time we get to the Super Bowl. So keep that in mind when you're watching this game. Speaking of this game, it is February 11th at 6 p.m. on CBS. Chiefs, 49ers. Let's go in. Let's look deeper into this matchup. We're going to start with the offense and the season rankings for the offenses, and you can see it is one-sided. It is the San Francisco 49ers with all the green on their side, and you can see the big difference here, the running game. Yes, the running game, and not completely surprising, but the Chiefs have had good running this season, but with Christian McCaffrey, he's just a different level back. And so that's one thing that jumps out to you as you look at them as far as season long goes. But look at this. Even rushing yards after contact, the Chiefs are 30th. The 49ers are third. Huge difference. So you can put hands on Christian McCaffrey. Doesn't mean he's going down. He's getting a lot of yards after contact. So that's a big thing there. Also, points scored, you can see Chiefs are middle of the road. They're ranked 15th. 49ers are ranked 2nd. So that's another big difference. Also, quarterback rating. Look at this. Kansas City Chiefs ranked 19th in quarterback rating. 49ers are top dogs. They are number one in that category. Also, in the red zone, that's another big one. Chiefs are ranked 19th. 49ers, top dogs there too, ranked 1st. In red zone offense. We go to the defensive side of the ball for the year and look at this shift way over to the Chiefs side of things, and passing yards against, Chiefs ranked 4th, 49ers ranked 13th. Rushing yards against, though, the 49ers do win that category. They're ranked 3rd to the Chiefs 16th. Any other big ones here? Red zone defense, Chiefs ranked 8th, 49ers are ranked 15th, and third down conversions. Also, the Chiefs are ranked 5th in holding the opponent in the red zone, where the 49ers are ranked 24th. So, very good matchup if you look at it on a whole year basis on how these teams stack up offense, defense. Let's take a look over the last three games of how these two teams compare. And you can see it's the Kansas City Chiefs and a big advantage here. Now, like I always say, just because you have the green on your side doesn't mean it's a huge advantage. So let's look at some of these and see where we do have a pretty sizable advantage. One would be quarterback rating. Kansas City Chiefs actually lead in the last three games. We saw for the year, the 49ers led, but in the last three games, Kansas City Chiefs 100.7 quarterback rating to the 49ers 90.1. So we'll start with Kansas City first. Here, Kansas City is averaging more passing yards and passing touchdowns. They have allowed fewer points per game, which is pretty sizable, I believe. Let me find that stat. Chiefs right now, 13.7 points allowed over the last three games. 49ers have allowed 24.3. So that's a big difference there. Better defense on third downs and red zone for the Chiefs. They have zero interceptions thrown over their last three games, so that's a big part of their success. Has averaged 2 sacks per game over the last three. That also is a good sign for the Chiefs' defense. And they have been perfect on field goals, and that's a big difference because 49ers, not so hot on field goals. So let's talk about the 49ers real quick. Right, 49ers averaging 4.5 yards per carry. Good stat, but not much different than the Kansas City Chiefs. Chiefs are averaging 4.2 yards per carry over the last three games. So very, very close there. Zero interceptions thrown by the 49ers as well. So both quarterbacks are doing a good job making good decisions over their last three games. Over 50% on third down offense for the 49ers. So interesting matchup there because they're doing pretty good offensively, but Chiefs are very good on defense of stopping you on third downs. So again, we've got a good matchup there. 49ers, 89% in the red zone offense. That also very, very good, very impressive. Averaging one interception on defense per game. We just talked about it. Chiefs haven't thrown in any interceptions, so we'll see if they can get one off of Patrick Mahomes there. And then kicking field goals has been a struggle for the 49ers. They are, in the last three games, 50%. That is bad. That is really, really bad. So if this thing comes down to a field goal where the 49ers are going to need one, everybody is going to be sitting on the edge of their seat because there is no gimme in this one. Jake Moody has been very, moody, I guess, as far as his kicking has gone this season. And that was very surprising because when he was with the Wolverines, he was very accurate, but not so much in the San Francisco Bay Area. So I wanted to take a look even closer here, just head to head, so we can compare the numbers right across the board. And this is for their seasons. And you can see Brock Purdy does have the better rating. We just talked about it, 113 to 92.6. Interceptions, Patrick Mahomes has thrown a few more, 14 to 11. Touchdowns, Brock Purdy's thrown a few more of those, 31 to 27. Yards per attempt, you can see Brock Purdy throws a little bit deeper. Touchdown percentage, Brock Purdy. Longest throw, 76 yards for Brock Purdy, 67 for Patrick Mahomes. So really, when you look at this as a whole, I do think the 49ers offense is the more proven offense as a whole. But if you're going off of trends and recent, what have you done for me lately? I do think it goes to the Kansas City Chiefs. And that's why this is going to be such an intriguing matchup, because both have a leg to stand on. It's just who's going to come out in that game and really perform at their highest level. And you know for a fact, Patrick Mahomes always can perform well in the Super Bowl. Rushing, Christian McCaffrey, Isaiah Pacheco, we talked about him. Pacheco having a great season, really kind of had to come in and do more than I think anybody really expected that he was going to have to do. Played in 14 games, 935 yards, 7 touchdowns. Christian McCaffrey, knock on wood, for the most part, stayed healthy this season, got into 16 games. Yes, he dealt with some injuries, but in the past, Christian McCaffrey's had a lot less games per season because of injury. So he didn't have that kind of injury and still put up huge numbers, 1,459 rushing yards, 14 touchdowns, 72 yards was his longest run. I mean, just really, really good. And look at the average per rush, 5.36. That is a great average. So is Isaiah Pacheco. 4.56 is very good average. But again, Christian McCaffrey, just a different level. And then receiving, I kind of wanted to break it down by the top four receivers because these two offenses really use everybody to catch the ball. You can see Christian McCaffrey, the number two receiver on the 49ers, and Travis Kelce, the top receiver for the Chiefs. But if you just look at these numbers, and we don't have to go over everything here, but you can see Brandon Ayuk, very good season. Deebo Samuel, the only reason he's not leading the team, I guarantee you, is because he did miss a few games in the middle of the season, and that's when the 49ers really struggled. So every time he's been in there, he really is the go-to guy for the most part. But with that, you can't sleep on Brandon Ayuk, who's having an amazing season. George Kittle as well. Now, we talked about George Kittle. He's banged up, you know, so what will that do to his effectiveness? I don't know. But if he's on the field, you have to still respect him. And then, again, Christian McCaffrey, dual threat. This guy can run the ball. He can catch the ball. He's getting touchdowns. He's just very, very good and very impressive for sure. We go to the Kansas City Chiefs side of things. And, again, Travis Kelce, another amazing season for him, 986 yards, 5 touchdowns, averaging 10.58 yards. So very good there. yards per game, 65 yards out of Travis Kelce. So he's still just one of the top tight ends in the league. And then Rashee Rice, for all the wide receiver controversy that these Kansas City Chiefs had all season, it really did end up being Rashee Rice who was the Mr. Consistent for Mahomes to really have as a weapon. And you can see he played 16 games, 938 yards, 7 touchdowns. Isaiah Pacheco, kind of like Christian McCaffrey, just on a little bit smaller of a level, but he is also dangerous catching the ball. And then Noah Gray, another tight end, also comes in fourth receiving for the Chiefs. So to me, yes, again, this not really surprising. 49ers have maybe more weapons at the top there. When you compare Deebo Samuel to Noah Gray's output, it's not even close. When you compare Isaiah Pacheco to Christian McCaffrey, you know, it's like half of what McCaffrey's doing. So, I mean, there is a difference here. There is a clear difference between these two offenses. But again, if you look at just the last three, it does favor the Chiefs. Defensive side of the ball, you can see the sack leaders for these two teams, Nick Bosa and Chris Jones, both 10.5 sacks this season. Interception leaders, Javarius Ward, 5, Legarius Sneed, 2. So again, advantage there for the 49ers with the interceptions. So prediction time. With all that said and done, with all the stats in, with you're looking at the year, you're looking at the last three, whatever you want to look at, you want to look talk about just experience in the Super Bowls, because that would definitely favor the Chiefs. But what team is going to walk away the champions? And I'm going to go by what I've basically felt all season long. I think I said it back in week 2 or 3 that this team was in Super Bowl mode. They just looked different. They felt different. When you watched them, they just were different. And despite or in spite of a Deebo Samuel injury that really made this team look bad in the middle of the year, he came back, they fought through it, and they finished where I expected, and a lot of people expected them to, and that was right here in the Super Bowl. So with that, I'm going with the prediction of the San Francisco 49ers will win this year's Super Bowl. So with that, what happens next year? Well, for the Lions, the road to, and you can see I left it open, because I don't know, guys. I don't think a road back to the playoffs is a shoe-in next year. This year, we were absolutely given an easy schedule. I said that before we even played a game this season. I said we had a very favorable schedule. And that's why I think I took every loss so hard, was because we shouldn't have been losing a lot of those games that we did. And that's why I took the 49ers loss so hard, because getting back to this point next year is not a given. Look at the teams that are on our road back to the playoffs next year. You're talking a lot of playoff teams, or very close to being playoff teams, on our schedule. We'll play the Houston Texans, the Buffalo Bills, the Rams we get again, the Cowboys, the Green Bay Packers, who will only be better than they were this year, the Seahawks, the 49ers, heck, even the Cardinals. The Cardinals will come into the next season ready to go. They dealt with quarterback issues this year. The Jaguars, the Buccaneers. There's a lot of good teams, guys. Not to mention our same division rivals that we get every year. You know, you still got to go through the Bears. As bad as the Bears were, they still can show up and snatch one. Same with the Vikings. So this is a tough, tough road that we will be on next year. Am I saying we can't make the playoffs? No. There's still a lot to be decided, guys. There's a lot of free agents to deal with. There's drafts to still have. There's coaching to still get dialed in. So there's a lot of questions going into next year. But just looking at it as it is, as we stand here today, I am telling you, this is a much tougher schedule than this year. That is a guarantee. And that's why Dan Campbell has to mature at game management, because when you get into dogfights against all these teams, you will not be able to have four failed fourth down conversions and walk away with a win. So this is going to be a tough one. But how sweet will it be if we get back to the playoffs with a schedule like this? So we'll deal more with that, and we'll dig deeper into that before next season. But I at least wanted to throw it out there and get you guys in the know of who do we have. Now, what week are we playing who? That hasn't been decided yet. Just the teams have been decided. And so this is who we're going to be seeing next year. So when does the new league year start for the NFL? The new league officially begins March 13th at 4 p.m. At that time, that's when free agency and trading begins. So mark your calendars. March 14th, 4 p.m., free agency and trading begins. Negotiations between teams and agents of pending unrestricted free agents can begin on March 11th at noon, but official deals cannot be signed until 2 days later. Detroit Lions 2024 free agents. NFL rosters never look the same year to year, and that will be true for the Lions. Even with most of the key contributors returning, dozens of Lions players will be free agents this offseason, including starters on both sides of the ball. Here are some of the key players whose contracts expire. And I broke these down. Kind of position to gather them all up so it'd make it easier to look at. Offense, we've got 9 free agents. One that we can definitely say will not be back is Teddy Bridgewater. He officially retired. Nate Sudfeld is a unrestricted free agent. Shane Zylstra and Brock Wright, the two tight ends, both are restricted free agents. And I put the definition of what these are on the side if you guys want to pause it and dig into that. But I know a lot of times people get confused about what the unrestricted, exclusive, free, all that. All the definition is on each slide here that I'm going to be showing you. So you can pause it at any time and read through that if you want to know more about that. Wide receivers, Josh Reynolds and Donovan Peoples-Jones. And I know. A lot of people not happy with Josh Reynolds right now because of some of the drops. But look, Josh Reynolds was a key component to our offense and success this season. So we should remember him more for the good stuff than just a couple of big moments down the stretch, because he's still just 29 years old. He does seem to have good chemistry with Goff. And so I would imagine we're going to try and bring him back. Donovan Peoples-Jones, I'm not so sure. He's only 25, but he kind of came over on a whim and never really did a whole lot. But that doesn't mean that they didn't see something that they want to bring back. So all these free agents, you know, potentially could be back. It's just going to be who's available in replacing them and what we get in the draft and all that good stuff. But just want to at least put the names out there for you guys. Running backs Craig Reynolds and Zonovan Knight, both free agents. But you can see Zonovan Knight is exclusive rights, which I guess I should run through that one really quick just so you guys know what that means. If an exclusive rights free agent is given a qualifying offer, he has no recourse other than to play for his current team. His only other option would not be play football. So basically, if the Lions say, hey, Zonovan, we want to, you know, give you a qualifying offer, he's a Lion. He can't go anywhere else. He can't negotiate. He can't do anything. He's exclusively the rights of the Detroit Lions unless they say otherwise. And then fullback Jason Kabinda, I would imagine he'll be back. But again, he did deal with some injuries that cost him some time this season. So that could play into the Lions' decision as well. Special teams, we got 2 long snappers, Jake McQuaid and Scott Daly. Scott Daly is a restricted free agent. And then kicker Michael Badgley, which, you know, a lot of the conversation coming out of that game against the 49ers was that Dan Campbell had to go for it on fourth downs because he didn't have the faith in Michael Badgley from that distance. And my thing is, if that's the case, then we cannot bring Michael Badgley back because I didn't feel like either one of those were out of the question field goals. Definitely the longest one, which I believe was a second fourth down we went for. Look, if you don't have the confidence in your kicker at that point to make that kick, then that's not the kicker that you need. So we need to go and improve our kicking game for sure. And I think every Lions fan would agree with that. Offensive line, we've got five free agents on the offensive line. Graham Glasgow, who is now going to be 32, and that's as of December 1st of this year. Jonah Jackson, 27. Halapulivati Vaitai, 31 years old. And then tackles Dan Skipper, 30 years old, and Matt Nelson, 28 years old. Defensive line, we've got three free agents. Romeo Aquara, Charles Harris, both 29 years old. And then defensive tackle, Benito Jones, 27 years old. And then finally, the secondary, we've got 10 free agents in the secondary, which pretty much everybody you talk to says this is where the Lions need to improve. This is where they've got to go spend some money, spend some draft picks. And again, I think everybody agrees with that. So who are our free agents? Well, we've got two safeties, CJ Gardner-Johnson and Will Harris. Both are free agents. A lot of people saying they don't want CJ Gardner back. They feel like his attitude is just wrong for this team's chemistry, and he talks a big game but then can't back it up. I actually like CJ Gardner probably more than a lot of people did, but we'll see. You know, again, put your work on the field, and then let's measure it out to the other options. And he was banged up, so he did not get to perform nearly what we thought he was going to be able to this season. But the hard work he put in to be able to come back before the end of the season, I think, says a lot about him as well. So, yeah, do you want a quiet, meek, not going to talk any trash to the other team? But he might, I don't know. I like the attitude. I'm going to put it that way. Let's just put it out there for the things that people are saying about CJ Gardner of why they don't like him. I actually do like him, because I think you do need to have a voice out there. You need a pit bull. You need a guy that's going to, you know, get in under the other team's skin, let's say. And I think CJ does that well. Now, does he get beat at times? Yeah, he does, but I don't think he got beat the worst out of some others. So, I mean, again, I would like another season. I wouldn't go long-term with this guy, but I would throw him another year and pray that he stays healthy and then get a true sense of what he does for this team. Linebackers, Jalen Reeves-Maybin, Julian Aquara, Anthony Pittman, and James Houston, all free agents. Anthony Pittman is restricted. James Houston, exclusive rights, which I just talked about what that is. So basically, James Houston, I think, will be back with this team. And I think that's a great, great thing to, a great piece to get back. And then finally, we got four cornerbacks, Emmanuel Mosley, Kendall Vildor, Khalil Dorsey, and Jerry Jacobs. Jerry Jacobs is restricted. Khalil Dorsey is exclusive rights. Jerry Jacobs, I think, got beat a lot this season, and I don't expect him to be back. Kendall Vildor, I did like a lot of what he did down the stretch. Yes, he had the ball go off his mask, and I'm not going to hold that against him. But I think he did a lot of good stuff down the stretch. So I would like to see them bring him back. And then salary cap. The base salary cap for the 2024 NFL season is $242 million, according to Over the Cap. And the adjusted salary cap will be $246 million, according to SportTrack. The Lions currently have $183.5 million in active contracts and $1.4 million in dead money, bringing their total cash spending to $184.9 million for 2024. The Lions will have an estimated $61 million in cap space. That's the seventh most in the NFL, according to SportTrack. Over the Cap projects the Lions will have $45.2 million in effective cap space, which is a projection of the team's cap space after signing at least 51 players and its projected rookie class to the roster. So just after all those numbers, basically what we're saying is $45.2 million is basically what you can figure. The Lions can go out right now well, not right now, but when the free agency opens, they can go out and spend that on free agents, $45.2 million, which is good. That's good money. That's, like I said, seventh best in the NFL. So they're sitting pretty good. They've got a lot of options to go out now on the market, see what's out there compared to what they've got, and then still to go and perform in the draft. And look, if we can turn around and have a draft like we did last year and have that many guys come in and start playing in the starting spots and to perform, then that right there fixes a lot. And again, that came from the Detroit Free Press, all that information right there. So that's it, guys. Just wanted to run through that real quick for you guys, so you guys kind of know what we're walking into now with the offseason, what we're expecting, who the free agents are, who, how much money we've got, and all that good stuff. And then, of course, yes, the draft is still coming up. So a lot of stuff, a lot of exciting stuff to still go on with the Detroit Lions. Some news, like I already said, with the coaching staff and all that, still good. Teddy Bridgewater retires. I mean, that means Hooker's probably going to step into that number two spot, which a lot of people are excited about Hooker, and they should be. He was an amazing quarterback out of Tennessee in college. So we got him due to really injuries that he suffered, and we were the first ones willing to take that gamble on him. That could really pay off. I said that early in this year. I said I like that move. I like that pickup. It's not going to mean anything this year, but in the future it very well could. And whether it even be maybe through a trade later on. But I still like the Hooker pick last year in the draft, and I'm so excited to see what we do in this year's draft, because I'm telling you, we really are very good at drafting now with the new front office we've put in place. We know what we want to go get. We know how to draft. We get the most out of our picks, and it really showed this year. Our draft last year was a huge point of emphasis on what we were able to do this year. So to improve, to kind of have some solidified spots too that we definitely need to upgrade, knowing that, hey, we need to upgrade right there, and we can't wait. That's where you go and you attack it with the draft. And look, if it's not available in the draft, like I said, we've got the money to go out in free agency and spend some money too. So the Lions in a very good spot, but a very tough schedule as well. So it'd be very interesting to see how all that plays out. And now we just wait for the Super Bowl. To be honest, I'm not really looking forward to the Super Bowl. I'm not going to lie. I'm rooting against Travis Kelce and Taylor Swift, and I'm over it. I don't want to see it. I would have loved to see the Lions go. There's no doubt about it. I really think we had our opportunity, but that's not even why I don't want to watch it. It's more just to do with all the hoopla around the Super Bowl. You pull in all these artists that don't care anything about probably football, but yet they're the halftime show. And then all the people that tune in for these stupid commercials, and it's anything but football at the end of the day. It feels like it's anything but football. It's always just a stupid side stories, and it doesn't feel like it's even the same season anymore at that point that you get to the Super Bowl. But I'll be watching it. I'm throwing a party, and we'll go through all that and just hope for a good game. But I'll be openly rooting for the San Francisco 49ers, no doubt about it. And so I'd be very interested to know what you guys are rooting for and what you're thinking about the matchup as well. So, of course, if you wanted to, you can contact us at the contacts that I will be listing one more time before we close the show. And also one more time before we close the show, I want to remind you guys about Spotlight Tribute Episode 1, Tribute to the 80s, playing now on Rumble, YouTube, and at heavyhitternetwork.org. And then also Fielder's Choice Baseball, February 10th, returns to the network. National League West, Diamondbacks, Rockies, Dodgers, Padres, Giants, all being projected for the upcoming season. And a full breakdown for sure. If you guys have not checked that show out ever, it's really the show that started the entire network. So it's my love and my joy to really talk baseball, dig into baseball. And so, yes, I think you guys will definitely be big fans of that show if you're a baseball fan. And then again, if you want to contact us, let us know what you're thinking about the Super Bowl, about the baseball, upcoming baseball season, about the 80s tribute show, anything else you got on your mind, you can contact us through email, heavyhitterspodcast@gmail.com. Call the hotline 1-616-258-6386 or chat with me on the website heavyhitternetwork.org. Or before you leave, you can tip the host by scanning the QR code to the right or hitting the tip jar on Venmo at Mario Romanelli. But that's going to do it, guys. So once again, thank you so much for watching, and I hope I gave you guys enough information to go away with, giving you more of a sense of maybe how the Super Bowl is going to end up. At the end of the day, Patrick Mahomes has a lot of experience in the Super Bowl, and you cannot take that away from him. He's very experienced in this. He does rise up for the big games. You can take all the conspiracy theories you want to about how this thing's going to end, because there's definitely plenty out there, and we might get into that conversation later once the season's done, because I do have some thoughts about that. But for now, we're going to keep it just focused on the Super Bowl and who we think is going to win or who we want to win. And like I say, with that, I'm the 49ers. Go 49ers. And, well, we will see you next week. Well, it's probably 2 weeks now, because Super Bowl is in 2 weekends. So I will be back on the Wednesday following the Super Bowl. That Wednesday morning, show will be ready for you. And maybe sooner. We'll see if I can turn a show around quicker than that, since it will just be a quick Super Bowl coverage. I'm going to try and get that out sooner than making you guys wait for it. So that's going to do it, guys. And like I say, go check out the Spotlight Tribute to the 80s, and then get ready for Fielder's Choice Baseball Show. But until then, you can go watch all the old shows at heavyhitternetwork.org right now. So until then, ladies and gentlemen, thank you once again. Take care of yourselves and each other. I'm out.
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this. I did it my way. Regrets I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew, but through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way. I've loved, I've laughed and cried, I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that say, not in a shy way. Oh no, oh no, not me. I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say the things he truly feels, and not the words of one who kneels. The record shows I took the blows and did it my way. Yes, it was mine.